Most journalists at first said Julia Gillard's speech sounded good, but was a bad defence of Peter Slipper. But when some foreign websites and thousands of tweets called it terrific, many said, wait, maybe Gillard was great. Mark Textor of Crosby, Texas, one of Australia's most successful pollsters and campaign strategists, and has worked on Liberal campaigns. Mark, good to see you, but take us inside the strategies of both sides. Now, first, Labor's spin team is running hard on Gillard's speech going big on social media. Now, does that make it a winner?
Well, I think there's two things here. Did it go big on Twitter? In a way, it did, and in a way, it didn't. It certainly got, you know, tens of thousands of retweets. However, when you compare that to the 10.3 million retweets of about the presidential debates the week before, I think it was, it's nothing in comparison.
Labor spinners did actually, though, draw the attention of journalists to the foreign reaction to try to get them off the meme that was going around that it was an inappropriate speech, saying, look, overseas they love it, you're wrong.
Yeah, well, we've gone from the cultural cringe to the political cringe. One of those websites, of course, was Jezebel.com, which had on its front page, I think, at one stage, JFK's threesome. So I wouldn't take that as a credible source. I think what's going on here is that, essentially, for the last 2 years, Labor has been mired in politics. And what they're trying to do is effectively create, through cohort analysis of a particular part of polling, to draw Tony Abbott into this strange world of Canberra politics, where essentially they want him to talk about commentators talking to commentators, about Twitterers talking to Twitterers, about politicians talking about politicians. That's essentially what happened last week. There's a growing frustration with the political class about a lack of action on the real issues. And so if you draw your opponent, in this case Tony Abbott, into a debate about less important issues, then what happens is you remove the differentiation which has been the advantage for Tony Abbott. That is, he is fighting for real issues and Labor is mired in politics by miring him too in politics.
Well, that's an attempt also to drag the journalists into the Twitter sphere, which seems to me a self-referential bubble. That's how... It's a self-referential bubble, isn't it?
It certainly is, and it does span the globe. It moves very quickly amongst the elites and the chattering classes, and they tend to get very excited about the politics of politics. What we now have, Andrew, in the world and in Australia, is a two-speed political economy. You've got our class talking about the derivative of politics, so you have a real issue, it quickly then derives into some bizarre analysis of issues, whilst the common man, the working man and the working woman, are catching up with the more basic issues, like the funding of the NDIS, about Australia's debt levels, about quality health and education services, and about the state of their roads.
Well, I was talking to you earlier about this, and you were saying to me, and this surprised me, that the footage that probably counted more with voters this week was not Gillard versus Abbott and the sexism debate, but scenes from the visit to Greece, for example, symbolically, of German Chancellor Angela Merkel and the protest by Greeks angry at the terms Germany is the money for bailing them out. Now, what made you say that?
Well, I think there's a contrast on two levels. Firstly, as it relates to female politician, there is a female politician who has been electorally successful in her own right for some time, is a very, very strong woman, never complains about sexism, and is holding the fate of entire countries and hundreds of millions of people in her hands. So that's the first thing. And there's much more world attention, significantly more world attention on what she is doing to save the European economy than a speech in Australia about politicians. The second thing I'd say is there's an increasing sense of vulnerability to the troubled world economy in Australia. They want our economy inoculated from it. To a greater extent. That means relying on more than a one-pillar economy. And so when you get quite powerful visual signals like this from Europe, it is noticed and it does have an effect
Mark Textor, we've run out of time. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Andrew.